on top of the world.
Well, actually, North Pole is south of Fairbanks.
Oh, is it?
Yeah, it's like to the southeast. Like, it's more east than south, but yeah, North Pole is kind of south of Fairbanks. Which, it's like a 45-minute drive, but I was like 23 or 24 when I went, so I couldn't rent a car at the time. But yeah, it's technically south of east of Fairbanks. One of these days I'll go back because I really liked my time in Alaska.
Yeah. I've been to Europe 4 times and I don't care to go back. I've seen them. But Alaska,
yeah, I have to go back to Europe at least one time to do this tour. A lot of the guys have other people that they didn't get a chance to.
Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to University United Methodist Church. We are glad you are here. We are glad you are worshiping with us. We have one announcement. We have a special charge conference that has been called today at 10:15, and the purpose of the charge conference is to vote on the sale of the property and the parameters and all of that. It is at 10:15. You may be thinking, wait, we don't get out till 10:30. It's going to be a little bit shorter of a service, a shorter sermon. Basically, if you do not want to, if you do not want to stay, simply, when it's over, leave. We will not be greeting at the door because we will be transforming the place into a meeting room and to get ready for the charge conference. So just want to let you know that it'll be a benediction and you may go in grace. With that said, prepare your hearts, prepare your minds, prepare your bodies and souls for worship as Ken brings us the prelude.
Good morning, University Church.
Good morning.
Would you please stand and let's do our call to worship? God hears and accepts our prayers.
Don't be concerned if you don't know how or what to pray.
It doesn't matter.
For God's Spirit is right here with us,
praying in and for us. Join us in our opening hymn, please.
Thank you.
Would you join us in our opening prayer? Our Father, our King, our God, may your name be sanctified. Reign thou over us, O Lord, for you, in loving kindness and tender mercy, clear us in judgment. O God, the needs of your people are many, their knowledge slender. Give everyone their daily bread and grant them their urgent needs. Forgive us, Father, for we have sinned. Pardon us, our King, for we transgressed. For it is you that pardons and forgives. Blessed are you, Lord, who is gracious and abundant to forgive. Compassion, all afflicted among us. Be our guardian, our advocate. Redeem us speedily from all evil. For in you we trust as our mighty Redeemer. May it be thy will, O Lord, God, to place a light and not in darkness. Our scripture reading is from Romans and also from Matthew. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought. But that very Spirit intercedes with groanings too deep for words, and God, who searches hearts, knows what is in the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. Pray then like this: Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
We come today looking at the Lord's Prayer. And we will be spending 5 to 6 weeks looking at this prayer. It's a prayer that is central to most of our faith. It's a prayer that, well, let's just be honest, it's a strange prayer. I mean, we call it the Lord's Prayer, but the Lord is never mentioned. It's a prayer that is prayed in almost every church every Sunday, and yet it never mentions church. It's a distinctly Christian prayer, maybe, but it never mentions Christ. And yet this is a prayer that is central to our faith. We have, in the early church writings, three references to it. The first is in Matthew. It's what we read, probably the most common. We also find it in Luke, but it's a much shorter version. And then we also find it in early church writings in a book called the Didache, which means teaching. It was a book written around the first century, and it's about the teachings of the church and how the church is to be the church. It has things like, how do we baptize? How do we do communion? And how do we worship? And in there is the Lord's Prayer. And so we come to look at this prayer. And it's one of those prayers that, I don't know about you, but somebody just has to say, Our Father, what are you doing? Who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. And you kind of go. And there are times when you could just say, Our Father, and I start racing it off in my head. Hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as in heaven, give us a day. And I just kind of want to get through it. And I want us to slow down. Pray about it. Actually not speed read the prayer, but pray the prayer that Jesus taught. And I don't know about you, but when Jimmy read it and then said, the word of God, thanks be to God, I wanted to end it because it didn't end correctly, did it? I was like, wait. It just ended. It's, at least not in temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. But yet that is not in, I want to say that's not in Scripture, but it might be. If you are reading the King James Version of the Bible, and you happen to read Matthew 6, 9 through 13, that will be the ending. But it's in no other Scripture. Anyway, what? So what was happening was this prayer was said in churches at the time of the writing of the King James Bible. And just as we have call and response, they had call and response, and they had a doxology. And at the end of the Lord's Prayer, if the priest was saying it, all the people would say, For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. So that is how the church knew the prayer. So King James just threw it in. And that's why it's in the King James Bible, which is very interesting. But this is what we have. We have the Lord's Prayer. And I sort of think, well, where did it come from? I mean, Jesus just said, hey, pray like this, pray this way. Well, his disciples came to him and said, Jesus, teach us to pray. And isn't that something we all can say? Teach us to pray. In fact, many of us will say, I don't know how to pray. I can't tell you how many times I've been in a meeting and asked, not calling people out, but hey, would you end the meeting in prayer? Oh, no, I'm not good at prayer. I don't know how to pray. Many of us think we don't know how to pray, and I want to tell you, it's simple. Because the great thing about prayer is there's no wrong way to pray. Prayer is simply conversations with the divine. And I want you to think about that. And we'll go into it a little bit more because there's more to it than that. But think about prayer as conversations with the divine. Think of it as if you're talking or in conversation with anybody else. Now, I did have a friend once tell me, we have two ears and one mouth, and that's for a reason. And when we're in conversation, we should do more listening than talking. And I'll just be fully honest, sometimes my prayer life, I do more talking than listening. And I think that's what we mean when we say we don't know how to pray. We don't know how to listen for God. We don't know how to pray as we ought. And Paul understood this. I mean, Paul even said, we do not know how to pray as we ought. But don't worry about it. Just pray. Because the Spirit is with us. That's basically what the Romans verse is saying. The Spirit intercedes. The Spirit is present. And we'll get to that in the moment. So what is it about this prayer? Again, where did it come from? Well, earlier on today, about, 10 minutes ago, we said an opening prayer. I hope you were listening. I hope you listened to it. I'm going to read it again just in case you don't remember. And what does it sound like? Our Father, our King, our God, may your name be sanctified. Reign over us, O Lord, for you alone in loving kindness and tender mercy clear us in judgment. O God, the needs of your people are many, their knowledge slender. Give every one of them their daily bread and grant their urgent needs. Forgive us, Father, for we have sinned. Pardon us, God, our King, for we have transgressed. For it is in you that our pardons are forgiven. Blessed are you, O Lord, who is gracious and abundant to forgive. Look with compassion on all afflicted among us and be our guardian and our advocate. And redeem us speedily from all evil. For it is in you we trust as our mighty Redeemer. May it be thy will, O Lord, our God, to place us in light and not darkness, and may our hearts not grow faint, nor our eyes dim, O Lord of the universe. For it is revealed and known before you what is our desire and your will. And you may hear that, and you may think that's a rephrasing of the Lord's Prayer. Actually, what that is the six lines of a Jewish prayer known as the Amah. It's the first six, not the first six, but six lines of a Jewish prayer known as the Amah. And just like our Father, once you say the first line, people would immediately know what comes next and go into it. And the Amah was a Jewish prayer that came about around 300 BCE, and it was 18 prayers. And what you would do is, if you were a devout, righteous Jew, in the morning you would get up, you would face Jerusalem. I don't know which way Jerusalem is, but you would firmly plant your feet, and you would start these 18 prayers. It would take about an hour, and then you would do this again at noontime, and then in the evening as the sun set. And this is what observant Jews did. Although Jewish people around 100 BC, just like you and me, are busy people. We might not have time to spend that much time in prayer. So rabbis started shortening the prayer. They started paraphrasing this prayer, kind of like what we read as our opening prayer. It was a paraphrase, just the first lines of, six of the first lines of 18 of the prayers. And so what Jesus is doing is he's taking a known prayer, a prayer that Jesus as a rabbi would know, and paraphrasing it. And devout Jews would have known this. they would have known what goes in to that prayer. Pray then like this. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Paraphrasing even more, boiling it down to the essentials. It is a prayer for people. It is a prayer for the world. It is a prayer of restoration. It is a prayer of equality. And in the Greek, it's, well, let's talk about that. But in the Greek, it's a prayer that has parallel lines. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. There's almost a hymn to it. Give us this day, forgive us our trespasses, lead us not into evil. In the Greek, they are parallel and look very similar. It's a mnemonic device that makes it easy to remember. So it's something that we would remember. And we'll get into this next week, but one unique thing about the Lord's Prayer is it's actually in two languages. It's in Aramaic and in Greek. Part of the reason is the church was moving from the Jewish way of being into the Greek way of being. But I think that's significant that it's in two languages. For me, that says this prayer is for all people, everyone. Give us, all of us, our daily bread, not just those we like, not just those who conform to the rules of the church, etc. And then we get the disciples are coming saying, Lord, teach us to pray, for we know not how to pray. And I don't know about you. I don't know if any of you struggle in your prayer life. Full confession, it's not always easy. And so I thought, well, what does Scripture say about prayer? And Paul says, pray constantly. Are you serious, Paul? I mean, that's why Jesus shortened this prayer. People couldn't pray constantly. We are busy. We can't just be talking all the time. But remember, Paul says prayer isn't just talking. Prayer is being with the Spirit. So be in the Spirit constantly, because the Spirit intercedes in our prayer life. We may not know what to pray. And if you've ever been in a situation of tragedy, a situation of stress, you know we don't know what to pray for. God's will be done, but I want it done my way. How do we pray? And so we look to the Psalms. And the Psalms are the liturgy of the Hebrew church, of the Hebrew faith. And they are prayers. They're prayers of asking, prayers of complaining, prayers of lament. God, why? Why, oh why, my Lord, have you forsaken me? Why do I not feel your presence when I'm going through this? Where are you? Lord, I need your help. God, pray for me in thine presence of my enemies. And then there's also the thanksgiving, prayers of thanksgiving. God, for all that you have given, all that you have blessed me with this day, the sun, the rain, the ground beneath my feet, even my breath, thank you. There are prayers of gratitude. And I think we're really good at those prayers of asking. And sometimes that's what we think of prayer. It's like a wish, our wish list. God, we want. We also need to be willing to say, God, we thank. We thank you for the life that we have. God, yes, we wish maybe it was better, but thank you for the life we have. And that's basically the Psalms. It's prayers of asking, prayers of petition, prayers of crying out. Why? prayers of God we don't understand. But thank you. You have our gratitude. And then there's the prophets and their prayers. And as I started to read, I read, God does not want your prayers. God does not want your worship. God wants justice. And I thought, yes. The prophets even say, I don't have to pray. I'm off the hook. But that's not it. It's the prophets are using hyperbole. God doesn't want your empty prayers. God doesn't want your empty worship. God wants your action. And this is where I think that idea for Paul, the Spirit, comes in. You see, a prayer isn't just saying, God, we want. You take care of it. When we pray, we are entering into relationship with God. We are entering into a partnership with God. Therefore, I believe when we pray, we must be willing to be that answer to prayer. We must be willing to be that answer to someone else's prayer. We can't simply say, God, we pray for those who are affected by the earthquake and think we're done. That's the extent of our responsibility. If we really want to pray for God, we pray for people in need. We have to be willing to be there for people in need. It's not simply a, God, we lift it up to you for we're off the hook. I mean, don't get me wrong. God can take that prayer and do things that we cannot. If we are praying for a friend or a loved one who has cancer, I am not saying go out and become a cancer researcher all of a sudden, but there are things that we can do. And I think, well, I'm just going to be honest. COVID kind of disrupted our prayer life because for me, one of the greatest prayers given is that casserole dish. I don't know if you've ever received a casserole dish from a church. Usually, I'll just be honest, they're not good. Yours are. Yours are. But when somebody is going through a hard time, when their loved one is suffering, the church, particularly the United Methodist Women, or now United Women of Faith, will gather and bring a casserole dish. That dish is a prayer. That dish is saying, we care about you. We care about what you're going through. It's simply not a meal, but it is a prayer, and it is prayer in action. And I believe that's what God calls us to. God calls us to that prayer in action through the work of the Holy Spirit. And it can be as little as a casserole dish, offering in the offering plate, going and sitting with someone who is struggling, who is suffering. We're not going to take away the pain, but we can be there present for them in the moment. You see, I believe that's part of prayer. It's a spectrum. It's an ask, a lament, a thankfulness and a gratitude, and an entering into the kingdom of God to be the hands and feet of Christ. That is what prayer is about, and I think that's what we see in the Lord's Prayer. We can't simply pray, give them their daily bread and not work so people have bread. And I think as a church, we've lost that idea. We've bought into this idea, or at least we have allowed society to buy into the idea that we believe prayer is nothing more than a wish, nothing more than a thought. Oh, God, help them. I'm off the hook. And we see this in social media. We've seen it recently whenever there is a mass shooting, whenever there is a natural disaster, people will say, you're in my thoughts and prayers. And someone will say, we need more than thoughts and prayers. And I want to tell you that for me at least, prayer is a call to action. Prayer is a call for me to start making a difference. I can't pray for change and not be a part of that change. That prayer is a prayer to God to make a difference as much as it is a reminder to me that God works through me, in me, through you, and in you. And I think that's what Paul meant when he said, we do not pray as we ought. I think that's what the disciples meant when they said, Lord, teach us to pray, because they knew how to ask, even what to ask for. It's how do we step out in faith to be that answer to prayer? And as we go forth, we will start to look at what is the Lord's Prayer really saying? And how does it speak to us? How does it speak to our community? How does it speak to the world? How does this prayer that we say is Christian call us into service into the entire world, regardless of their faith? And I say that knowing that when there's a disaster, we will pray for those people. We are praying for those who are affected by an earthquake. Well, how do we then live into that? Well, one way is through God's tithes, our gifts, and our offering. Because when we give, a portion goes to support UMOM or UMCOR. We have so many names. United Methodist Committee on Relief. And I want to share with you that when I started out in ministry in seminary, I had a friend who went to work for UMCOR. He went to work for the United Methodist Committee on Relief, and one of the things he said is, you would be amazed at the letters we get from people in church saying, why are you helping those people? They're not Christian. And he said, we have forgotten what it means to live our life in prayer. It's not just for those who look like us, act like us, think like us. But if we are truly to be people of prayer, we are to be that answer to prayer to all God's people, all God's children, which means all of humanity. May it be so, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I'm not going to have a pastoral prayer, because I'm going to invite you to be that prayer. To be that prayer out in the world, to be that prayer here and now, to live into that faith, knowing that prayer is asking, prayer is lamenting, prayer is giving, prayer is thanksgiving, prayer is gratitude, and prayer is doing and calls us into action. With that said, I invite the ushers to come forward for the giving of God's tithes, our gifts, and our offerings. Thank you.
Gracious God, take the gift that we have given and our lives offered to you. Use both and bless both so that our offerings and our lives may be the answer to someone's prayer. This we pray. Amen.
I invite you to go forth into this world, go forth in prayer, and know that the Spirit intercedes with and for and through you. Amen.